Salutations, celestial sightseers. I'm David Fuller. Welcome to Eyes on the Sky. What's up this week? The moon was new on November 3rd, which means that for Monday evening, those with clear, transparent skies and an unobstructed west-southwestern horizon can try to spot the very young, one-day-old moon. Trace a line along the ecliptic from Venus towards where the sun would be below the horizon. The moon will be slightly above this line. Using the simple hand measuring techniques, estimate about 30 degrees from the brilliant planet. This is about where to find the very slim crescent of that one-day-old moon. Now, binoculars will help, but seeing it naked eye is both a challenge and exciting to have accomplished if you do manage to see it. I'll have more information on spotting it at eyesonthesky.com. 2 days later, the 15% illuminated crescent displays both Mare Crisium and Mare Fecunditatis. To the north of Mare Crisium is the massive crater Cleomedes. With a small telescope, look for clefts and small craters on the floor, along with the central peak. In the southern section of Mare Fecunditatis, check out the shadows of the craters in and around Colombo. By the early part of the weekend, the three big craters near Mare Nectaris, Theophilus, Cyrillus, and Catharina, are dramatically shadowed, with the central section of Theophilus standing out in stark contrast. This isn't just a central peak either. It's a mountain chain within this 100 kilometers diameter crater, and the mountains here rise up to 2,000 meters in height. And now this week's dark sky fact. Simple, small changes to our lights can make a big difference. Look at how the street light one house away from our house dramatically altered the glare shining towards a bedroom window, while keeping the intersection below it well lit. Learn more about how this street light got changed and how you may be able to get yours changed too. Comet Ison has generated a lot of attention over the last year or so, having displayed a rather significant coma quite far out in the solar system, raising observing expectations. First, temper expectations. It is not brightening as quickly as hoped, so it may not quite be the comet of the century as some have hyped it to be. That said, it is brightening in the morning sky, and on November 7th, it will be very near the third magnitude star, Beta Virginis, easily within a telescopic field of view of the star. That morning, the comet should be around magnitude 7, bright enough to be seen in binoculars under moderately dark skies, or in telescopes under more light-polluted ones. But that's not the only bright comet to see in the night sky. There are two other comets that have had unexpected outbursts lately. Comet 2P Encke will skim past Zeta Virginis by just 3 degrees on November 9th and 10th, and should glow around magnitude 6, which is a full magnitude brighter than Ison. This comet drops towards the morning sun just as Ison will be, and the two will be in a fairly tight 5 or 6 degree circle with Saturn and Mercury later in the month. What a photo opportunity that will be. And last but not least, the comet C2013R1 Lovejoy is the fourth comet discovered by Australian Terry Lovejoy. This comet is also apparently fairly bright right now and is actually much better placed for viewing. Look in Cancer the Crab, where this comet will buzz past the Beehive Cluster on the mornings of November 6th and 7th. There will be links to finder charts and observing information at eyesonthesky.com. What a month November 2013 is turning out to be for comets. Grab your binoculars, set your alarm clock to get up early, and catch these cosmic interlopers before they zip back out of our region of the solar system. Jupiter has a few more double shadow transits left before the month is out, but it's also just a degree away from NGC 2362, the Eskimo Nebula. That's all for this week. Keep your eyes in the sky and your outdoor lights aimed down so we can all see what's up. I'm David Fuller, wishing you clear and dark skies.